it's happening. I forgot to bring the minutes with me today, but by sheer luck, I was wearing this junk drive, now there's a around my neck, and the minutes are on it. So I'm having my brain replaced by my computer parts right now. President Ruth McDermott called the 2,222nd meeting to order at 8:15 p.m. April 29, 2007 in the Powell Auditorium of the Cosmos Club. The recording secretary read the minutes of the 2,221st meeting. They were approved. Ms. McDermott made announcements. She made a pitch for volunteers to help the society by contributing effort, by financial contributions, and by bringing friends. She made the parking announcement. Ms. McDermott then introduced the speaker of the evening, Mr. Tony Tether, director of the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA. DARPA is the central research and development organization of the Department of Defense. It manages projects where the risk and payoff are both very high and where success could provide dramatic advances in military missions. Mr. Tether referred to us to a book that he brought, nicely bound and covered, that explained DARPA more fully. He recommended it to all parties, saying it was written simply, and added with no apparent connection that it was written for Congress. DARPA is run, he said, by 100 to 125 program managers. These people work for DARPA for 4 to 6 years. DARPA's personnel program allows management to make a person an offer and have the person working in the afternoon. People have to give up everything to come to DARPA. They become civil servants, and they have to accept post-employment restrictions. Very few of them ever see their ideas brought to conclusion. That would take too long. They are strange people, he said. He presented the organizational chart. At the top are himself and Bob Lenny, the deputy director. There are some staff offices, which he put in one box. There are 6 program offices, and that's the end of the chart. I can assure you that that probably is the simplest organizational chart that represents the expenditure of $1.5 billion a year of public funds. He described the 6 program offices are tactical technology, information exploitation, strategic technology, defense sciences, information processing technology, and microsystems. Mr. Tether said that if he could, he would have all his people working on one floor and have co-ed bathrooms. DARPA's role is to bridge the gap between applied research and basic research. Applied research is conducted by organizations hoping to profit from the investment. Universities conduct basic research, which leads to results in the long term. The gap between them is where President Eisenhower found the problem when the Soviets launched the first orbiting satellite. The agency sponsors research, the services won't support because it's risky, does not fit their specific role, or challenges existing systems. The agency works to develop capabilities commanders may want in the future, not capabilities they know they need now. The agency insists that all programs start with good ideas and good people to pursue them. In the 60s, DARPA developed ground surveillance radar and the Saturn program. Saturn was what gave President Kennedy the confidence to say we could get to the moon. In the 70s, low-cost titanium was a DARPA project. Titanium had been too expensive to be useful for many military uses. DARPA came up with a way to separate some of the titanium from its associated oxygen and use the remaining titanium oxide for other uses, thus reducing the cost of the titanium. DARPA's best-known creation to date is the Internet, which began in the 60s and 70s. The original network was the ARPANET, and its associated TCP/IP network protocol for transferring data from one computer appliance to another. The fundamental element of public and private networks was, and is, packet switching, developed by DARPA. The things DARPA is now working on include a chip-scale atomic clock. Such a clock could be built into the computer chips and relieve them of dependence on external time sources. The accuracy that they're looking for is 1 microsecond a day. They're using their hold-a-contest strategy to generate possibilities. They're also working on alternative energy sources. One possibility is a high-efficiency solar cell. Current solar cells use only a small part of the spectrum. DARPA is working on an idea to use prisms. Now, these are harder to flip over than a solutions to separate the spectrum and thereby hopefully be able to use more of it. Another idea is biofuels from crops. They can make JP8 from rapeseed or some kind of some other oilseed crop. They have a petascale computer on the drawing board. It would excrete 10 billion MIPS, billion instructions per second. They're working on less expensive space launches. They feel a big hurdle to utilization of space is the cost of getting up there. One possibility is to use airplanes to get some of the load partway up. He likened what we do now, load all the fuel on board for the whole trip at the beginning, to buying a new car with fuel in it, with enough fuel in it for 100,000 miles. Vaccines are also of considerable interest in the military, and DARPA in particular. The health of soldiers has always been a major factor in military efforts, and now the health of civilians is as well. At present, it can take 15 years from discovery to a vaccine we can use. The problem is large-scale manufacturing, which currently involves eggs made from eggs from very special chickens. An alternative approach is to use industrial fermentation. His favorite project, and he apologized for having a favorite one, involves a monkey at Duke University named Aurora. Aurora has a probe in her brain, which is less than 1 micron wide, which picks up signals related to hand and arm movements. Aurora used a joystick to move a robotic arm to get food to her mouth. The brain signals were also connected to the robotic arm. After a while, Aurora realized she did not have to move her arm. Her brain signals controlled the arm and brought food to her mouth. He recalled the many people at Walter Reed without limbs. He believes that one day, not too long hence, amputees will have complete functionality just like they had before. He described a program that's generated great interest, the DARPA Grand Challenge.
Of language, how it is learned and how it changes. Mr. Lightfoot heads NSF's Directorate of Social Behavioral Economic Sciences. This directorate is comprised of three divisions: behavioral and cognitive sciences, social and economic sciences, and science resources statistics. It encompasses fields such as anthropology, psychology, cognitive studies, political science, linguistics, risk management, and economics. Hey, maybe some hedge funds should take a course from him. Previously, he had served as dean of the Graduate School for Arts and Sciences at Georgetown University and a professor in its Department of Linguistics. In his capacity as dean at Georgetown University, he promoted research correlations into cognitive and neurosciences, population health, bioinformatics, statistics, and computing. Prior to that, Mr. Lightfoot established a new department of linguistics at the University of Maryland and chaired it for 12 years. Previously, he held academic positions at the University of Michigan, McGill University, and the University of Utrecht in Netherlands. He has held numerous visiting appointments in Europe and South America. Mr. Lightfoot received his bachelor's degree from the University of London, King's College, and his master's and doctoral degrees from the University of Michigan. He has been a Fulbright scholar and has received fellowships from the Ford Foundation and the American Council of Learned Societies. He has authored 10 books and several dozen scholarly papers on the origin, acquisition, development, and historical evolution of language. Mr. Lightfoot, please.
Can you hear me without the microphone?
No.
Better use the microphone. evening, I want to talk about a very complex system that each of us have in our brains, which ranges over our language capacity. And one of the things I want to do this evening is to show you just how complex that is, and to show you how smart you are, and to show you that you're a lot smarter than you think you are. And I find that audiences tend to be receptive to the proposition of that title. And then we'll ask, given how complex it is, how does this get acquired by children? And so the first question to ask is, what happens when language emerges in a child? And we need to recognize that they don't learn English. There's not an object out there that all of us glommed on to. So for example, take a sentence like, she might could see it. Would you say that? There's nobody here from Tennessee or Arkansas. Because if there were, the hands would have gone up. What about bitter happy? Would you say that? Yes. If you're from Cornwall in the UK, that means, is she happy? Right. And so what happens is nobody acquires English, which has this kind of range of phenomena, but rather we develop some private system. And each of us in this room, I hope for the purposes of this lecture, have a private system that enables us to communicate with each other, okay, over a certain range. And so we want to know how that developed in us as children. And one thing to recognize is that none of us at this stage of our lives, or when we were children, are just imitators. Okay, so there's an easy answer to this question. How do people attain a mature capacity in English? Well, by imitating. But that's far too easy. All of us have the capacity, which we exercise all the time, every minute of our lives, to use novel sentences and to understand sentences that we've never heard. And that's true of young children. Young children use novel expressions, often sort of expressions that don't occur in adult English. They're not models that they're following, but they have a system at a certain, at the age of 2.5, which generates a certain capacity. And so what we acquire, what we all acquire in the first few years of life, is some sort of finite system, a system that's represented in our brains, so therefore finite, which ranges over infinity, and an internal language. That internal language, in all cases, has recursive devices and is compositional. What I mean by that is, let's take recursion first. Everybody, no matter what language they speak, has three recursive devices that in principle, if we live long enough, will enable us to produce a sentence of indefinite length. Okay? One of them is relativization. Okay? And we produce very complex clauses, and we do this sometimes to bore young children to sleep. And we say things like, this is the cow that kicked the dog that chased the rat that killed the whatever, that caught the mouse that nibbled the cheese that lay in the house that, and so on. Okay. So it's one relative clause after another. I think there's 7 there, the last time I counted. But we could do 9, we could do 13, we could do any number. And all languages have that looping device, okay, that recursive device. Second one that they have is complementation. One can say ad nauseam or ad mortem, whichever comes sooner. Ray said, that K said, that J thought, that Faye said, that Gay told, and so on, indefinitely. And the third recursive device that every language has is coordination. And one can say things like Ray and K went to the movie, and J and Faye went to the store, while Gay and May and Clay worked for Shay and Jack and so on and so three devices, which of course can be combined, which enable us to produce sentences of indefinite length. Well, that's kind of a technical demonstration of a capacity that is there, we can sort of see on an intuitive basis. And that is that almost all of our language experience is novel. Okay. So the last sentence I just uttered is hopefully not one that I've uttered before, except perhaps the last time I gave this talk. It's not one that you've heard before. I have no difficulty uttering it. I'm not uttering it because I heard somebody utter it when I was 13 years old. And you are not understanding it by analogy to something that you heard when you were 13 years old. And this is just, it's part of the human language capacity. It's a profound aspect of that capacity that grows in us, that grows in every child in the first few years of life. A second property of the human language capacity is that it's compositional. It consists of units which have subunits. And so an expression like, whatever this is, saw a man with curly hair, has those units. So curly hair is a unit, okay, but with curly is not. Okay, so in this diagram, there is no node that dominates with curly and only with curly. Okay. And so a diagram like this defines the units of the system. And we'll see in a moment that the system that we have is a sort of computational system that has operations which apply to these units, the units that are given in this kind of compositionality. So this is just a property of every of the human language capacity as it develops in every human being, regardless of whether they're being raised in some sort of roughly English-speaking community, Japanese-speaking community, or some Bantu community. It's not learned, it's simply intrinsic to the species. These are properties that hold of human beings. They hold, as far as we know, of no other species. But it goes way beyond this. And language is shot through with what we call poverty of stimulus problems. This is fundamental. And so young children have a stimulus. They hear stuff. And on that basis, this system develops in them. But the properties of the system are not determined fully by the stimulus. The stimulus is too poor to determine everything that we know. Okay, and that's what I'm going to show you. So I'm going to show you that you know things that you didn't learn. Okay, somehow they've grown in you. So the challenge then is to explain how these things have grown in you. So here's a poverty of the stimulus problem. This is a form of reasoning that goes back to the Greeks, got biology off the ground in the middle of the 19th century, and linguists are using it now. So there's a perfectly normal expression of English. Kim is taller, okay? And here's another one, Kim's taller. And so as young children, we heard people using is in the full form, and sometimes in the reduced form, okay? And so we're smart, and we figured out that there's an operation which applies to a bunch of verbs whereby they can be reduced, and they can be kind of slurred in their pronunciation. That's fine, and that's learnable. So that's there in the experience that any child is going to have. Sometimes the child will hear am, and sometimes the child will hear mm. Okay? So that's in the experience, and therefore it's learnable. Here comes the poverty of the stimulus problem. Take a sentence like, Kim's taller than Jim is. That second is not reducible. The underlined is not reducible. Nobody would ever say, Kim's taller than Jim's. It's just not English. You wouldn't say that, and your 2.5-year-old, with this audience, grandchild, we would say, I wonder what the problems with him. Now, this is a poverty of the stimulus problem, because you know, okay, so until at the moment, you know subconsciously that there are certain instances of is that can reduce, and certain instances which do not reduce. And so we're in the process of making that subconscious knowledge conscious. Right? So we're looking at this now as scientists, as analysts. It's not the case that as children you just imitate what you hear. So it's too easy to say children don't say that because they never heard it. Okay. Language acquisition doesn't work that way. Okay. There's no evidence that children ever go through an experimental stage experimenting with sentences like that. No, and their parents, you know, hit them across the ear or take their lunch away for 3 months, and you know, they learn not to do it. That's not the way that language acquisition works. So that's not part of the input, but it's part of what we all know in maturity. So that's an example of the poverty of the stimulus problem. And language is shot through with this. Essentially, every generalization that you can find, like this one, is can be pronounced is. Every generalization breaks down. Okay? There are exceptions. We'll see some more as we go along over the next half hour or so. And the question is why? So here's another one. In English, you can say things like, Peter said that Kay left the book that Kay wrote. So what we call subordinate clauses are typically introduced by a word that. Okay? And in English, that word can be deleted. It needn't be there. So equally well, one can say, Peter said, Kay left, with no that. Or the book Kay wrote arrived. Or it was obvious Kay left. Okay, that's fine. And so we say there's an operation in English whereby these sentence introducers can be deleted. So that's what this means. That can become zero. That's true for speakers of English. It is not true for speakers of Dutch, or speakers of French, or speakers of Italian. Okay. It's actually a relatively unusual problem. But children hear both forms. Sometimes the that will be there, sometimes the that will not be there. And so this operation, that is deletable, is learnable. Children have the experience which warrants that generalization. And so everything's hunky-dory. This is true of the mature capacity, and it's learnable. But that doesn't always happen. So take a sentence like, the book arrived yesterday that Kay wrote, or that Kay left was obvious to us. The corresponding sentences without that are garbage. Nobody would say, the book arrived yesterday, Kay wrote. Okay? You wouldn't talk like that, right? It's not English. Or, Kay left was obvious to all of us. So you need to have the that there. Here's another poverty of stimulus problem. Okay. So your stimulus warrants a generalization that may be there or may be deleted, may be absent. Okay. But there are cases where that operation does not apply. And we have no evidence for that. That is to say, there's nothing in the child's experience that shows that doesn't happen. The child's experience is a bunch of expressions. They hear things. What they do not experience is what linguists call negative data. You can't experience something that doesn't occur. And what we're talking about here is information about what does not occur. That's not part of the experience of the child. It's part of what the child comes to master. It's part of the output, if you like, of learning. But it's not part of the input. And so this is part of the complexity. So here's stuff that you all knew, okay, before this talk began this evening. You knew it subconsciously. Okay, now we put it up on the screen. It's in PowerPoint, okay, so now you're conscious of this stuff. And we've got an analytical problem. How come this this holds of our mature capacities? Well, here's a principle. So what we want to say is that there are simple things that get learned by children. But then also there are simple properties that are sort of built into what it means to be human. So the human beings have a language capacity. Other species, as far as we know, do not. Okay? They don't have the same language capacity, that's for sure. Well, what does it mean to say that they have a language capacity? Well, part of what it means to say that is that they have recursive devices. Part of what it means to say that is that they have a compositionality, as we discussed a few minutes ago. And part of what it means is that deletion operations take place only under certain configurations. So we've got a computational system which develops in us as children. It's part of the finite system that grows in us, that gives us the capacity to communicate in the way in which we do. And that grows by a combination of simple things that get learned, interacting with, as far as this evening is concerned, one simple principle which is sort of intrinsic, which is built into the species. And the combination of those simple devices getting learned and the simple principle built into the species gives you the complexity. Okay? So that's going to be the approach to showing how such a complex system can emerge in children under normal childhood conditions, where children are hearing stuff and developing a capacity which makes them human beings. And so the principle is that something is deleted, the details need not be concerned, if it's the complement of an adjacent overt word. So, what does that mean? So let's go to the example we just looked at. So Peter said, K left. Okay, so there that has been deleted. And that clause, okay, K left, is the complement of said. What Peter said is K left. Said is adjacent to the clause. It's overt, it's pronounced. And so deleting that in that context is fine. Similarly, the book K wrote, that has been deleted. The clause K wrote is the complement of book. It completes the meaning of book. Book is adjacent, so that's a position in which that can be deleted. Okay. On the contrary, the book arrived yesterday, K wrote, okay, that's not English. There you've got a clause, K wrote, where the that has been. But the clause is not the complement of yesterday. It's the complement of book. It completes the meaning of book. It does not complete the meaning of yesterday. So that's not a position in which that can be deleted. K left was obvious to all of us. It's not a sentence of English that has been deleted. But there's nothing adjacent to it. So that's not a position in which that can. So under this view, we can say there's a simple operation that gets deleted. That children learn, English-speaking children learn, Dutch-speaking children do not. And there's a principle which is built into us that deletion takes place only under certain configurations. And the combination gives us the complexity of the system. Here's another example. In English, we can have empty verbs. We can say Jay spoke at 6 o'clock and Faye spoke at 8 o'clock. Or we can say Jay spoke at 6 o'clock and Faye at 8 o'clock. Okay, there's an empty verb there, which is understood to mean spoke. Alright, so it's E for empty. So there's sort of an operation that yields empty verbs. But now notice, you can say, Faye said Ray left, and Kim, that Kim stayed. Perfectly fine. Right. There you've got an understood verb, followed by a clause. But what you don't get is, in red, red means, doesn't occur, Faye said Ray left, and Jim stayed. It's not English. Right. Why not? Because the that at the front of Jim stayed, that clause, right, is the complement of the understood verb, the empty verb, but that verb is not overt. So that's not a place where you can delete. Right. So we can say it's a simple operation that young English-speaking children learn, namely you can have empty verbs, and there's this principle built into the species that deletion occurs only in certain configurations. And that gives you the complexity. That shows you, that explains why the generalization breaks down. Okay, let's go back to our original example. So, is can be reduced. So you can say, is John is happy, or John's happy. But when you have the reduced form, it's kind of incorporated into the subject. So it's affected by the nature of the subject noun phrase. So you say, Pat's happy. Okay. That's what linguists call a voiceless sound, because what it's attached to is a word that ends in a T, as opposed to Doug's happy. Okay. What linguists call a voiced segment, okay, because it's attached to a word which ends in a voiced consonant. Or then Alice's here, where you have an extra syllable. That's because the subject ends in a certain segment where that's required. Okay. So the reduced is kind of incorporated into the subject. That's the way that needs to be analyzed. And children hear these alternations. That's learnable. Children can figure that out. So now let's take the examples where is not deleted. So Kim is taller than Tim is. Full form. That's fine. So the second tall is deleted. That's what the strike through means. And it's the complement of the verb is. That's kosher. But compare that to Kim is taller than Tim's. That's not English. Right? So the bold-faced tall, you see that's bold-faced in the second one, it doesn't delete. Okay? And it doesn't delete because there's no verb anymore of which it's the complement. The verb has been absorbed into the subject noun phrase. Okay? Take the other example. I wonder what the problem is with him. That's fine. What is understood as the complement of is, and it's deletable. Okay. It's the complement of is, and that's a position where you can delete. But you don't get, I wonder what the problem's with him. It's garbage. And the reason is that the bold-faced what has no verb to its left that licenses its deletion, because the verb has been absorbed into the subject noun phrase. Okay. So we have these simple operations. Is can be reduced by incorporating into the subject noun phrase. You could have empty verbs. You could have WH elements which move. So it's all learnable. Okay. Then you have this principle, which explains why it is we don't say the stuff that is sort of logically possible, but is not actually part of English. Okay, we'll take one more example, and this is a process called VP ellipsis. So you can say things like, Max left for Rio on Wednesday, and Mary did as well. Okay, there's an empty verb phrase there, which means what? Audience participation. Left for Rio, right? Leave for Rio, right? And so this is understood by analogy to an earlier verb phrase in the clause. Max left for Rio, although Mary didn't. Empty verb phrase, and the meaning is she didn't leave for Rio. Although Max couldn't, Mary was able to leave for Rio. So in all of these cases, there's an empty verb phrase, which is easily understood. And in the first example, you have you have two conjoined clauses. The second has a verb phrase, which is empty. In the second example, you have a main clause, Max left for Rio, followed by a subordinate clause, which has an empty verb phrase. That's fine. In the third example, you have the subordinate clause first, although Max couldn't. Mary was able to leave for Rio. Susan went to Rio, yes, but Jane didn't. And here you have separate sentences, perfectly easy to understand. Or even a very complex expression, the man who left for Rio knows the woman who didn't. Okay, so a complex structure of that one is fine. Or you can have a very simple clause, don't. And in an appropriate context, okay, where I go up to this gentleman, you might say, don't, okay, because he thinks I'm about to throttle it or something. If the context yields it, that's just fine. Well, that's fine, and that's learnable by children. Not all languages have this operation, but various forms of English do. But now look at this. There are cases where this breaks down. They denied reading it, although they all had. Perfectly fine, right? You know what that means. They all had read it. Now, there's a little operation in English which can permute what we call a quantifier and an auxiliary verb. So that gives us, they denied reading it, although they had all. Garbage. Nobody would ever say that. What's the difference between those two? In the first case, the empty verb phrase is the complement of had. Okay, completes the meaning of had, which is right there, adjacent to it. In the second case, they denied reading it, although they had all. The empty verb phrase is adjacent to all, but it's not the complement of all. It doesn't complete the meaning of all. So that doesn't occur. They denied reading it, although they often had. Perfectly fine. An empty verb phrase that you understand easily. But in English, you can permute certain adverbs and auxiliary verbs. And so you can get things like, they had often read it. But if you combine this, you get they denied reading it, although they had often. It's not English. In the first case, the empty verb phrase is the complement of had, which is adjacent. And in the second case, it is not the complement of often or certainly. One final example, I haven't seen that movie, but John has. It's fine. There, the empty verb phrase is the complement of has, which is adjacent. Everything swings. But not, I haven't seen that movie, but John's. Impossible. And the reason is that the reduced has, which has been absorbed into the subject noun phrase, therefore it's no longer a verb of which the empty verb phrase is a complement. So the picture that emerges is that children acquiring some form of English learn operations like these on this slide. That can be deleted, that you can have empty verbs, that is can be reduced, other verbs, and that verb phrases can be ellipses. And children can learn those four operations by experiencing sentences like Peter said K left, where Kay left is the complement of said, but there's no that. By hearing something like Jay saw Ray and Jim Kim, the second part of that sentence, there is no verb. By hearing something like Kim's happy, with the reduced form, and by hearing something like Mary didn't, where there's no verb phrase. So that is learnable. These are simple operations which are learnable, which interact with this simple principle which is built into the species, which restricts the way in which deletion takes place. It sort of it constrains the way in which the computational system operates. So that's the that's an approach to the complexity of language. The language is complex. I told you a bunch of things this evening that unless you be taking linguistics courses at Georgetown or at the University of Maryland, you didn't know. Okay. You didn't know consciously. You knew it subconsciously. You recognize what the kinds of things that your speech has and the kinds of things that your speech doesn't have. You don't say the stuff that's been in red on these slides. Okay. And so we say that that happens by children learning simple operations which interact with a few simple principles that are kind of built into the species that are, that in fact define the human language capacity. So the human language capacity has, as far as we're concerned so far this evening, has three principles. One is that there are recursive devices. One is that there is compositionality. And the third one, the one that we played with over the last 20 minutes, is that deletion operations apply only in certain structures. Okay. So how does that happen? If you'll permit a commercial, there's a recent book on this, on how new languages emerge. And the idea is that there are internal languages. Everybody in this room has an internal language, okay? Something which developed in us in the first few years of life. And then in addition to that, there are some social languages, and so this, which are very hard, in fact impossible to define. Okay. There is no definition of English, or you know, languages out there, Norwegian and Swedish. There's an old line, what's the difference between a language and a dialect? Anybody know the line? It's a famous line.
Language.
A language is a dialect that has its own army and navy. My favorite example from recent times is in 1992, there was a language, Serbo-Croatian. And then, you know what happened to Yugoslavia. So now we have three languages. Serbian, Croatian, and Bosnian. Nothing has changed linguistically. But the red lines have been drawn differently. The political boundaries have changed. The armies have changed. And so that's the... those are the languages. So this is an old distinction that goes back to von Humboldt in the early part of the 19th century. Pointed out that languages are, at one level, creations of nations, right? They're political entities, but they are personal and independent creations of individuals. And that's right. So, given that view of the complexity of the human language capacity, and given that view of how that complex capacity grows in us as children, okay, then how might we understand how it changes over time? Okay. So English, so now going to sort of a national notion of languages, has changed. Okay, there was Chaucer's English, which was different from Shakespeare's English, which was different from the English of Jane Austen, which is different from the language of George W. Bush. And so language changes changes over time. And how does that happen? And one of the things we've learned about this over the last generation or so is that it's a case of what in other contexts is sometimes called punctuated equilibrium. That is, if nothing much happens, and then there's a big structural shift. Okay. So punctuation. And language change operates like that. So I'm going to give you two examples. And here's one. So in English, you say things like, he has understood chapter 4, but you would never say he has, could understand chapter 4. Okay. So the modal auxiliary, like could, does not occur in the perfect aspect. Or you can say understanding chapter 4, but you can say canning understand chapter 4. Notice there's nothing complex about the meaning of that. Right? I mean, if people said that, what it would mean is he has been able to understand chapter 4, okay, but then he turned 50. Right? Or being able to understand chapter 4, right? He went to Starbucks. So, if these things occurred, they would have a perfectly transparent meaning. We say things like, he wanted to understand, but not, he wanted to can understand. Right? We say, he will try to understand, but not, he will can understand, unless you come from Tennessee or Arkansas. Okay. He understands music, but not he can music. So we have these pairs, right? And we all know this. Okay, now two facts. This is extremely unusual. If you do literal translations of those red sentences in your favorite European language, in French, or German, or Swedish, or Italian, they're perfectly fine. Okay. And furthermore, you go back to English prior to the 16th century, you find this stuff in the texts all the time. So something happened. And what happened was that these red guys were all red-blooded sentences of English until the beginning of the 16th century, and then they disappeared. Okay. And there's good reason to believe they disappeared together. So there was a shift, there was a single shift in English, which had the effect that all of those, five sentence types die out at the same time. Okay. The last person to speak this way, okay, was a very prolific writer. These forms show up all over the place in his writings, and that is, depending on how you feel about it, Sir Thomas More or St. Thomas More. And he uses all of these forms. So there was a shift in English. We know when it happened. It was complete at the beginning of the 16th century. And it affected all of these sentence types simultaneously. That's what I mean by sort of punctuated equilibrium. I'm not going to tell you why that happened. What happened was that these modal auxiliaries, these words, can, could, must, and so forth, became inflectional elements. So in early English, they were verbs, just like anything else, as they are in modern French, and modern Swedish, and modern German. And they moved to an inflection position. But by the time of the early 16th century, they became a different category. If you say that, you say there's that single change in the system, you have to take this on faith, unless you want to push me in the question period, and that explains why all of these red forms died out of the language and died out at the same time. Okay. Now that's not surprising on the view of language acquisition that we just developed. The children are learning specific things about a computational system. So they learn that delete sentence introducers. you learn that you can have empty purpose. So if you change that, if one of those things somehow doesn't get learned, then you'd expect a range of phenomena to change at the same time. And if you want to ask me why that happened, I'll be ready to answer that. Here's a second one. So I said to you that verbs used to move to an inflection position in early English. And at a certain stage in the 17th century, so a little bit later, that operation dropped out of the language. Again, this is specific to English. It has not occurred in French, German, Italian, Spanish, Romanian, and so on. It's happened in English, and only in English. And the effect is that we no longer say the red stuff. We no longer say, understands Caleb chapter 4. That's perfectly good English in the 16th century. And you see it all over the place in Shakespeare. We no longer say, Kim understands not chapter 4. Perfectly good for Shakespeare. We no longer say, Kim reads adverb, direct object. Okay. Perfectly okay in Shakespeare, and the translations are perfectly good in languages like French and Italian. And so there's a single change, where that operation was lost. Used to be the case that verbs move to inflection. That ceased to be the case. Shakespeare is a transitional character. He has both systems. And he alternates from one to the other. And here's three lines from Othello. So here's one line. Where didst thou see her? Modern system. O unhappy girl, little more sayst thou? Old system. I like not that, old system. What dost thou say, modern system? Alas, what does this gentleman conceive, modern? How do you, madam? That's the old system. So we see both systems coexisting in certain authors. In this case, Shakespeare is a good example. So again, we see a single change in the abstract system. This verb movement operation is lost. A bunch of phenomena change. And so, what I tried to argue this evening is that language acquisition happens as children learn simple structures. But those simple structures are subject to these intrinsic properties, what you can think of as the principles of the linguistic genotype. And the combination of simple learned structures and simple genotypical principles yields the immense, I hardly scratched the surface of this this evening, the immense complexity of what each of us knows subconsciously. Properties that hold our language capacity. And as different structures are learned over time, so language takes place in what's sometimes called a catastrophic fashion. In other words, big structural changes and nothing very much happening for a while, and then more big structural changes. Okay? So there's an approach to the complexity of language, a way of understanding it through interaction of simple learned things with simple intrinsic things, understanding how that gets learned by children, so children are learning simple things for which they have evidence in the speech around them. And that in turn enables us to understand why it is that at certain points in the history of English there are sort of structural changes where a lot of phenomena change at the same time. properties as a teacher. So the question now is, why did that happen? Why were certain verbs in English reclassified as something else? And the reason is that there was an enormous change in English over the Middle English period. So this is over the period from sort of the 12th to 14th century. And early English used to be like Latin. It had very rich morphology. So the shape of the verb would differ depending on whether the subject was first person or plural or second person and so on. So lots of different endings. We know this happens, and it happened in languages like Latin, it happens in many American Indian languages. And all of that got lost. Okay. Now you can ask me another question. Why did that happen? Well, we think we know why that happened. And that is that the Scandinavians came in. And the English love the Scandinavians. Well, more accurately, Scandinavian men love English women. But French men do not love English women. We know that for many hundreds of years of history. And there was essentially no intermarriage at the time when the French were in England. But there was massive intermarriage when the Scandinavians came in. Okay. So the Scandinavians came into the northeast part of England. And that's where the morphology got simplified first. Now, what you have in Scandinavia, so Old Norse and Early English, are closely related, but they're different languages. And there's good reason to believe that in a bilingual home, where you have a Norse-speaking father and an English-speaking mother, okay, there's enormous complexity in the morphological system, right, which is unlearnable. Okay, it's beyond what any child can learn. And so what seems to have happened is the kids said, "The hell with it." And we have this dramatic simplification in morphology, which happened in English for contingent reasons, because that's where the Scandinavians came. There's a reduction in morphology in other European languages, but there's nothing as dramatic as in English. Now, what that means is that after the reduction in morphology, there's one class of verbs that look at. There is one fact about English verb morphology in the present tense, and that is, in the third person singular, stick an S on the verb. Okay, so he reads. That's all there is. There's no other verb endings, all right, in English. But there's a certain class of verb, in Old English, there's a class of verbs called preterite presence that did not have that ending. Right? In Old English, kids were learning hundreds of endings, just one fact, it's no big deal. After the simplification of morphology, that became a defining property of verbhood. And these guys, can and may and so on, never had it. And what happened is they were reclassified. They were sort of separated out. So that's one way in which we can understand that. Now notice what we're doing. We're telling a contingent story. We're saying it happened in English at a certain time for certain reasons. What we are not saying is that languages in general tend to undergo this sort of change. That would be the wrong kind of story to try to tell, because that way you could explain how English has turned out. Then you'd have the embarrassing fact that the French, German, and so forth.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'm wondering if the word can, which seems to make so much of this transition possible, is related to what came down through the Scottish side as can, and how that relates to the vowel shift and if it's correlated at all.
Well, those are different roots. So can is to know.
I know. I can. I'm just curious if there's any any linguistic or significant similarity there?
Is there linguistic similarity? I mean, there's similar, sure. And interestingly, the Scottish verb ken, which is survived in Scottish English, was another of these preterite presents. But it got analogized to other verbs. So it continues to exist as a verb in Scottish English, at least in the 19th century. It's still used in the Scottish, but in certain verbs used it. So yeah, it's related, but it's related but different.
Please ask your questions loudly so that everyone can hear them. You had one, sir.
Thank you. You quoted Humboldt as saying that.
Turn partially around so people can.
You said that you quoted Humboldt as saying that nations develop language, but French and Spanish and German all developed before our nation states. So are you talking about nations or not nation states? Or I'm not clear.